grass laid because you'll never have to mow again.
Hi and welcome to Football Friday, our weekly dissection of the beautiful game. As ever, I have two learned gentlemen with me, David Fairclough from Liverpool and Everton's Graham Sharp. It's been a very interesting week, but one tinge with sadness for anybody who knew or who ever met Sir Philip Carter, the former Everton chairman who sadly passed away yesterday, age 87. Graham, top man in every department, Sir Philip.
Yeah, thorough gentleman. Was involved at Everton, you know, when I first came down in 79, obviously worked his way through Littlewoods, got onto the board. He was the chairman who could easily have sacked Howard Kendall in the early 80s when things weren't going well, but he stuck with him, and probably the most successful time in Everton's history. But he was a thorough gentleman, you know. It was an Evertonian, and he ran a very tight ship, and it was all about respect for Sir Philip. Obviously involved in setting up the Premier League as well, one of the founders there as well when he was trying to go with things. So, very learned man about football, and it's a sad loss.
I mean, both of us worked at Everton for a long time, and I think you have to work there to understand how influential he was. Mm-hmm. But not just that influential on a top level, but even in his 80s, he would come into the club almost daily to talk to the staff. Mm-hmm. You had a problem, you went to Sir Philip Carter.
Yeah, it was incredible. You know, the energy levels of him, he was 87 years of age, but he travelled home and away with the team as well. You know, and that wasn't going with the team, that was making his own way down, whether it was driving or whether it was flying himself down and his plane down to like St Norwich and places like that. So he was really, really into to Everton Football Club. But as you said, he was there not just for the footballing staff, but the general staff of Everton as well. If any had any problems, he could go and see Sir Philip and who would listen to him. And as I said, he's when you talk about Everton now, you know, I always associate Philip Carter, Sir Philip Carter, because he was a big, big player.
You mentioned there that Everton's history could have been changed dramatically mm-hmm. had he opted to sack Howard Kendall 83-84. And that would have been the easy option, mm-hmm. but he went against... most fans wanted Howard out at that point.
Well, definitely, and I think he was trying to build a football club, and I think, you know, Sir Philip had seen, you know, the success that Liverpool had with Peter Robinson, John Smith. It was the same sort of ilk as them, you know, and he looked at Liverpool and thought, listen, I need to try and build something here at Everton. I'm going to keep faith in my manager. As you quite rightly said, he was getting a lot of pressure from the supporters to get rid, but, you know, Sir Philip saw something in Howard and stopped by him, and as you say, the rest is history. Mm.
David, did you know Sir Philip?
No, not very well, I'll be honest. I knew one or two of the Everton directors down the years, and I did come in contact with Sir Philip Carter a couple of occasions, but not to any really great degree. But it came from an age where I think we could all associate with football. You know, the continuity existed, you know, and you were in touch with the common man. Unfortunately, it's changed now, and the Philip Carters and the likes and the John Smiths over at Liverpool are... you know, a long way gone, aren't they?
I mean, there are very few people, I suspect, who've got the respect that he earned within football, not just on Merseyside, but throughout the game. You mentioned Sir Philip Carter. You mentioned Everton and people say Sir Philip Carter.
Definitely. And, you know, I remember one instance when I had something that could have worked for me off the field in terms of promotion. And I thought, yeah, this is good. This is a nice little learner for me. I think this will be great. Looking forward to went to see Sir Philip. And he went, no, Graham. It doesn't paint Everton in the right image, so you'll have to say no to it. And I was like, oh, I said, I'm making some money here. And he went, no, it doesn't paint. And he was one of those, you know, he had the respect of the players, he had the respect of everybody, but also he respected Everton Football Club so much. Mm. You know, we talk about, read things about him this week, obviously he passed away yesterday, but he was actually born in Scotland and moved down here, you know, when he was a very young kid. So that was something they didn't know. But his wife as well, Lady Rita, lovely lady, obviously her thoughts and condolences by her and the family. But no, it's a sad, sad loss.
So Philip was actually working with him. He was an absolute perfectionist. What he used to do before every home game was he would contact Dave Harrison, the club secretary, and ask him for pen pictures of the opposition's directors so that he knew who they were and he could strike up a conversation with them. He didn't want to go in blind talking to somebody unless he knew something about them. And so he did his preparation before every home game.
Yeah, incredible. But even when I was playing in the home, and especially the, it was both home and away, he'd make sure he'd come down to the dressing room. Now, not come down to the dressing room and lord it, but just come down to the dressing room, go round every single player and say, good luck, good luck, good luck. And now, didn't stay there longer than he needed to. He just went round, good luck today, you know, all the best, and walked out. And he had a presence, you know, and he walked in the dressing room. The dressing room went quiet, you know, because Philip Carter, the chairman, was here. Here comes the chairman. So he had the utmost respect from the players.
Bill Kenwright will be absolutely devastated by this loss, won't he?
Definitely. I think Sir Philip came on back on board and he was confident to Bill. And it is a sad loss. And the chairman was, well, seeing the chairman now, our time, Sir Philip was fantastic, but the players as well. Everybody had the greatest respect for him. You know, he used to come into the dressing room, you know, 10, 15 minutes before the game and go round everybody and shake their hands and wish them all the best. But he never stayed in there too long. He knew he had a place and it was just to say everybody the best, get out of there kind of thing. But as soon as he walked into the room went quiet, you know, and everybody had utmost respect for him. So it is a big, big loss to Everton Football Club in general. But, you know, Bill will find it a loss as well. He was always there with him.
He was a funny guy as well, Sir Philip Carter.
Yeah, he was.
By the day we had Sylvester Stallone came to Goodison and I was deputed to look after him, and I brought him into the boardroom. Sir Philip shook his hand and then Sir Philip came over to me and said, who is he? I said, he's a major American film star. Would I have seen any of the films he's been in?
No, I don't think
so. I said,
so.
I don't think so. So he said, I won't bother talking to him then.
No, it's a sad loss, as I said. And, you know, we can sit here all day and talk about all the great things. But, you know, I think when you look back, you know, as I said, and his wife, Lady Rita, as well, obviously condolences to her and the family. But he'll be well remembered at Everton Football Club.
It's quite fitting, really, that we talk about Sir Philip today, because it's 30 years ago today of the famous Bayern Munich game at Goodison, the semi-final of the Cup Winners' Cup, the greatest night of football I've ever had, ever enjoyed. And I know the official attendance was 49,000. Yeah. There were more like 60,000 in Goodison that night. What are your memories and recollections of that?
Well, when you said to me earlier on it was 30 years, I wouldn't have thought
it's
that.
It's gone,
Sharpie. Yeah, it has, it's gone. I wouldn't have thought that, but... No, I think Evertonians talk about that night, you know, as many Liverpoolians will talk about the nights that they've had in Europe, David with St Etienne and nights like that. But certainly for Evertonians of that generation, that was a night that they'll never forget. It was probably the best game that I played in terms of atmosphere. You know, yeah, there was only supposedly over 50,000 people there. Seemed an awful lot more. It looked like 49,900 Evertonians and maybe 100 Germans. But, you know, that was... we looked at that game as a final itself, because we knew if we beat Bayern Munich over two legs, we'd play either Celtic or Rapid Vienna in the final, and we thought we could beat the two of them. Over in Germany, got a draw with a depleted team and got them back to Goodison. Fantastic night, 1-0 down at half time, and managed to score three goals in the second half. So once we'd beaten them, we knew that our name was on the Cup Winners' Cup.
I was actually in the press box on that night. I think I was working for the Times, and at half time, our colleagues from the German media were booking hotels in Rotterdam for the for the final. And I remember the Merseyside Mafia, as they were called, the Mersey press lads, said, just wait a moment. And the second half was astonishing, wasn't it?
Well, it was. And I think, not just the German press, but I think when we played the final in Rotterdam, there was hundreds and hundreds of Celtic supporters, because they thought they were going through as well against Rapid Vienna. And they'd booked their flights and their hotels. So... it was a very emotional night. Howard Kendall, famous talk at halftime, was, listen, keep doing what you're doing and the Gladys Street will suck one in. And that's what happened. You know, I got the slightest deflection on a header from a long throw from Gary Stevens. That was 1-1. And then after that, they wilted a little bit, you know, and we came to the fore and Andy Gray got the second one, and then Trevor finished it off. So a fantastic night. And as I said, I had many... of in-laws had come down from Glasgow, and they'd followed Celtic through their European campaigns in the 60s and the 70s, and they said that that night, that atmosphere was probably the best they'd ever encountered.
I mean, Bayern were later to accuse Everton of being over-physical on that night.
Well, it was a physical game, but, you know, they weren't angels either. You know, they could dish it out as well, but they had a really good team. They had... Augenthaler was a big centre-back. They had Søren Lerby in there. They had Rummenigge, Jean-Marie Pfaff, the goalkeeper. you know, they had a really Lothar Matthäus as well, so they had a really, really top side, but they could look after themselves as well. So, you know, it was a bit of a battle. They would have probably preferred it to not be a battle, but when they went into to Goodison and with the atmosphere of the crowd, they must have sensed, they know they're in for something different here. Unfortunately for us, that's what they got.
How many were in that ground that night?
Well, as I said before, and in many occasions, Jim Greenwood always used to say we're on a crowd bonus. So anything above 30,000 would get a pound. So Jim was probably counting the supporters in again. But I think there must have been, I'd say there must have been about 60 in there easy.
It was easy. I know it was Howard Kendall's favourite ever memory. Mm. OK, after the break, we'll come back and we'll look back at last weekend and another major disappointment for David's Liverpool.
Elite Lawns Artificial Grass, landscape partners with Tiger Turf. Free lawnmower removal with every grass laid because you'll never have to mow again.
And welcome back. Last weekend sadly brought more disappointment for Liverpool in the form of FA Cup semi-final defeat at the hands of Aston Villa, which nobody really predicted. You weren't here last week. Gary Gillespie was very confident that Liverpool would get through, as was Graham, as was I, as was everybody, I think.
Well, you know, I did think Liverpool were favourites personally, but I thought Villa gave Liverpool a bit of a hard time in January. In the league game, Villa had been having a bad spell and still under Paul Lambert at that point. But they played well against Liverpool, and I thought perhaps Liverpool would have the edge. But I still thought Villa was going to give Liverpool problems. I didn't think it was going to be easy by any stretch. And we both know what semi-finals are like. I mean, the most nerve-wracking of events, I think. And if you're going to go out in the semi-final, you want to go down fighting, really. But for Liverpool to go out the way that they did, I think disappointed an awful lot of Liverpool fans.
Where did it go wrong? Because, as you say, you've just touched on the word fighting. And Liverpool, I'm not saying they looked disinterested, but they didn't look anything like as committed as did Aston Villa.
No, that's right. And maybe it was only in the latter stages as Liverpool were battling for that equaliser, which you normally get with in a team in that from a team in that situation, that Liverpool looked anything like threatening, didn't they? I mean, they capitulated. Liverpool didn't look like they had any energy, whether or not the occasion got the better of them. You wouldn't have thought that would be the case, but it did look like some of them perhaps just didn't have the energy. Certainly the game plan didn't look perhaps as convincing as it has done in earlier stages of the season. In recent weeks, Liverpool have done okay, you know, until the United and the Arsenal games. But they looked the shadow of the team that perhaps went on such a good run, and I had people talking about them just a month or two ago.
What was your view of it, Graham?
Semi-finals, as David says, they're nerve-wracking things, and sometimes, for whatever reason, you just don't turn up, and I just don't think Liverpool turned up on the day. I was one that, alongside everybody else, who thought that Liverpool would win comfortably. We thought Villa, they are in a little bit of an upward curve, if you like, under the new manager, Tim Sherwood. But I thought in the semi-final, in the space of Wembley, I thought it would have suited Liverpool, you know, easily. Then they got off to a good start, you know, with Coutinho scoring a goal. But then didn't take it on from there. You know, OK, they have a debate near the end about the goal that should have been given. But really disappointed for Liverpool. And I could understand Liverpool fans coming back being disappointed because I think, you know, Brendan Rodgers was talking about winning trophies and, you know, that looked like their best chance this season. And, you know, to go, I hate to say meekly, but it was meekly. You know, they just kind of folded a little bit. And that's a disappointing thing because, and anyway, we talked about Benteke last week coming back and he's a big player for him, good goal scoring form, and he scored again. But I think Liverpool will be bitterly disappointed. You could see by the reaction of their players, you know, afterwards, you know, on the pitch, Steven Gerrard obviously wanted to go out in the last big hurrah, if you like, kind of thing. But I think the other players knew they didn't really perform on the day.
What I don't understand sometimes is that Brendan Rodgers, or any manager, he knows his own players, he knows how the opposition will play, so therefore he sets his team up to combat that. But he seemed to change the formation three times during the game.
Yeah, I mean, I'm one of those that likes to stick to what you're good at and really not always look to combat the other side, not overthink too much. Liverpool looked to be a little bit worried of the opposition and whether or not they were caught between sort of two stools as to how to approach it. But I would have rather have seen Liverpool really go for it and put made Aston Villa worry and put them on the back foot rather than allow them to almost dictate, really. Their system clearly upset Liverpool's. And then, as you pointed out, I mean, the game plan seemed to change, chop and change, and some of the players looked absolutely lost.
Sometimes in semi-finals, players freeze. You know, you could be coming into a great run of form into the semi-final, your favourites and everything else, and all of a sudden, semi-finals, there's so much pressure on you. You know, it's worse, I think, losing a semi-final than a final, because you're that close and you're thinking, yeah, OK, in a final, it's disappointing, don't get me wrong, but that semi-final, you're that close, you know, and you're thinking, yeah, this is going to be the one. And sometimes, for whatever reason, even us in the 80s, we were playing Luton, and we were awful against Luton, and we scored in the last minute, and we got out of jail. So sometimes it doesn't matter how you're playing in the league. When it comes to that semi-final, and it's all about nerves and everything else. I know a couple of years ago when Everton and Liverpool played in the semi-final, Everton were accused of not turning up, and the players, you know, bottling it, if you like. It's not like that, and the players aren't trying it. It's just sometimes on the day, they just can't live up to the expectations.
Yeah, something happens within your body. You're withdrawn of energy. Sometimes I think you're better off maybe going a goal down to sometimes kickstart you, because you can have that nervous energy of you're 1-0 up and now all of a sudden you think, this is it now, we're going to Wembley and this is it. And something happens. It's very difficult to explain why, but it takes a lot of application, semi-final, to come through, and it shouldn't be sort of ever accepted as a given. You know, we saw that from Reading the day earlier against Arsenal. I mean, no one would have predicted that game would have gone to extra time, I don't suppose.
I mean, Liverpool were poor, but to be fair to Villa, they were very good, weren't they?
Well, there's been a vast improvement. You know, we talked about Tim Sherwood last week, and, you know, some of his antics, you know, off the field and the touchline, I don't necessarily agree with, but he seems to have got a response out of the players. You know, they looked dead and buried, you know, a couple of weeks ago. He's got a response, and that's what you're wanting a new manager to do. And, you know, all credit to him for that. You know, he'll be looking now and, you know, to try and win that trophy for Villa. Again, they'll go into the final as underdogs, but, you know, he'll enjoy that. You know, and I think they're very near safe in the Premier League as well, so you need to take your hat off to him. But, you know, disappointment for Liverpool.
I think people will have their impression of Sherwood, but whatever he's done, I mean, he's clearly embraced some of the players. He's got them working for the team, which it looked like a lot of the spirits had disappeared from Villa. Benteke is in absolute hot form, so he had to be respected on the day, and it was probably on the cards that Benteke would be the major threat. But also what he's also done by introducing a young player who's actually sort of like brought a little bit of energy and not been involved in what had gone on previously with the other manager. It was just waiting to take his opportunity. And Grealish has come on and has been a revelation.
Yeah, he was terrific. Yeah. The accusation, of course, as soon as Liverpool lose one game, all the fans go to the Fodens and start condemning the club structure, the Americanos, the manager, the players. The main concern seemed to be from the Liverpool faithful was that they, you used the word bottling it, that they are losing the big games. Last season, Chelsea at home. The entire Champions League campaign this season was a disaster. Chelsea in the League Cup semi-final. And now this one. They just seem to not be able to carry it through. Just when you expect them to move to that final stage, literally the final stage, something goes wrong.
A Liverpool season, you break into stages, and certainly before Christmas, it was disappointing, and the Champions League run was handled poorly. I think, you know, the team selection on one or two games, the chances that they missed and what have you, Liverpool certainly would have been boosted had they gone into the second stages of the Champions League. But having said that, the reaction after New Year was superb. After Boxing Day, that seemed to start the revival. And the run that they went on, I think, was really, really pleasing. And I had all the country then sort of all of a sudden sitting up and taking notice again of Liverpool. But I think the fact that the last month or so has been disappointing, and losing some big games, Manchester United, Arsenal and Villa, the Villa game particularly, are the standout games. And it's the way that you lose those games that gets people worried. And it isn't just net, I think, that the fact that you lose a game, it is the way that you lose a game. And it's what, you know, how close you sort of, how close the differences between you and the opposition. And I think on those three occasions, I think Liverpool fans have been really disappointed. And it's just not like losing another game. It's sort of been meaningful. And I can understand a disappointment. I think Liverpool fans are a little bit worried. Is there optimism for the future? Is the club moving in the right direction in terms of...
That's the key question. Have they progressed from last season when they should have won the title? Do you think they've moved on?
No, I think they've been really hampered by the... Suarez going to Bayern and not replacing Suarez with the goals that Suarez scored. And Sturridge's been injured for a long, long time. You know, to win more games, you need players to score goals. And I think Liverpool have been hampered in that area. So that has been a big blow for them. You know, Brendan Rodgers, we talked about it last week, his transfer dealings. You know, have they worked, have they not? But I think that was always going to be a big ask to replace somebody of Suarez's class and calibre and the goals that he produced. So, you know, Sturridge has been in and out, you know, the onus has been on Sterling probably to score goals, Coutinho. And I think if you take a big chunk of the goals that Liverpool scored last season out of that team, they were always going to struggle. It was never going to be easy for them.
Well, I think they've scored 41 goals less this season than last season. I mean, okay, you can say that straight away. It's Suarez and Sturridge's contribution. But the forwards haven't added any goals. One goal from Barini, one goal from Balotelli. It's been poor, and losing somebody like Suarez, I think people can look, fans will look and say, if you lose somebody like Suarez, it's very naive to think that, you know, Liverpool were going to sort of be able to sort of to strike up the same type of challenge without losing one of the best players in the world. And then you got Sturridge having his injury problems. Sturridge is a bit of a question mark, I have to say. I think at times, I don't know, I'd like to have seen a little bit more fortitude from him. I'd like to have seen him say, you know what, I want to play. I want to be in here.
I'm in pain, but I want to play.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I've missed out on so much of the season. I'm going to go through the pain barrier and repay a little bit of something. The fact that he got a large pay increase while he was off injured, I mean, was strange. His value was going up daily the longer he was out of the team. And I don't think that was a healthy thing for them to do.
See,
really.
I worry about managers who start using the media to defend their position. Brendan Rodgers yesterday said, nobody is better than me for this job. Now that, I wouldn't put a pound on him being in charge next season, having said that. That's almost an acknowledgement from the manager that he is under pressure.
Yeah, it's a poor type of response, I think. I don't think you want to really get involved in that type of scenario where you're beginning to have to defend yourself. I mean, other people, you know, leave that to other people, really. I think things should speak for themselves, and if it's good, it's good. There is a little bit of criticism, but certainly, I'm not one for coming out and sort of saying how good, you know, an individual is, from a personal point of view. As I'd rather, you know, I think he's made a little bit of a mistake in saying that.
I think, as we've seen in the past, I mean, Henry and Werner, who own the club, the Americans, they can be very ruthless. They were ruthless with Kenny, and they will be equally ruthless if they believe there was a better man for the job. Now, Jurgen Klopp springs to mind here. Doesn't he think he'll end up in the Premiership?
Well, Jurgen Klopp, you probably look at his last few months of results and you probably say, well, no, he doesn't deserve that. You know, so it's a very difficult situation to be in. Brendan Rodgers is enjoying his time at Liverpool. He thinks he can take the club forward. Only time will tell whether he does or not. I'm not sure. I think all the criticism he's getting, of course, Liverpool want to be in with the tail end of the season challenging for things. But I still think he's got time. But I think the summer's going to be massive for him.
OK, we'll be back after this short break to preview this weekend's fixtures. Manchester United arriving at Goodison Park.
Football Friday, brought to you by Elite Lawns. No mud, no mowing, no mess. Elite Lawns Artificial Grass, landscape partners with Tiger Turf.
Hi, and welcome back. Both our great clubs will end the season without a trophy, but still some significant games to come, particularly this weekend. Manchester United arrive at Goodison, and that's always a good bun fight, isn't it?
Definitely. It's always a game you look forward to as a player. You know, Manchester United coming to town. They've improved. You know, they're in that Champions League spot now. They want to hold on to that. Some interesting matches as well. You know, Fellaini coming back to Goodison Park. Mm-hmm. Interesting what kind of reception he'll get, but he will be a danger. You know, I think Louis van Gaal knows how to use him now. I think when he first went into Manchester United, he wasn't too sure about him. But I think over the last month, 6 weeks, when United have picked up, Fellaini's been a big player for them, so we have to make sure that we're at our best tomorrow defensively.
Everton have missed Fellaini because he's exactly what they need now, I suspect.
Well, you're probably looking at him now and he probably wouldn't fit into the way that Roberto Martinez likes to play. You know, and I think everybody thought when Van Gaal came over to Manchester United, he was going to play this slick passing football, but even he knows that, you know, sometimes you have to knock it forward and pick up second balls, and they've done that. And Fellaini's done really, really well for them in recent weeks. He's been probably the star player. So it'll be interesting to see how we deal with them. They've got a few injury problems. We're getting results at the moment without necessarily playing well. You know, sometimes that's a sign of a good team. When you're not playing well, you're picking the results. But the game last week against Burnley was a slog, to say the least. But we got the 3 points, which was the most important thing. So going to the Manchester United game, full of confidence.
I find it's always interesting when Man United come to Goodison, or indeed go to Anfield, because Wayne Rooney never seems to perform when he comes back to Merseyside.
Why did you say that? You know, there's going to be a first sign for everything. But no, listen, he gets a hard time when he comes back to Goodison. Obviously, he's moved to Manchester United many years ago, but he's a quality player. You know, I think most importantly, on the weekend, we have got to take care of what we do. I think against Burnley again, I think we huffed and puffed. We missed a penalty early on. Again, it was a penalty saga. Who's taking the penalty? Ross Partley stepped up, took it. Goalkeeper saved it. Lukaku not being there was, you know, Pienaar not being there. Pienaar, we talked about him last week against Swansea. Pienaar was excellent. And I was looking forward to him playing and striking up that partnership with Leighton Baines again. But he was mysteriously out of the squad altogether, so obviously he's picked up another injury. But more importantly, we've just got to get back and try and win as many games between now and the end of the season, finish the season on a high, and look forward to next season.
The pressure's off now because they won't be relegated and they're not going to qualify for the Europa League. So, in a way, there's a sense of freedom. Do you think Roberto Martinez will experiment? I know he's got limited resources. Do you think he'll throw anybody in?
A lot of supporters are saying throw in the kids, you know, this is a temper. But no, I'm not having that. I think nowadays, you know, with Premiership places costing or earning you so much more money, I think it's important that you finish as high as you possibly can. You know, I still believe that, you know, if we can finish in the top 10, you know, it's not an achievement, don't get me wrong, but it's not as bad as the season as we thought it was. So it's important to finish the season on the high. I don't think we should experiment. We've got young players coming through, don't get me wrong, but I still think the manager wants to see an improvement in the team. Certainly from an attacking point of view, we talk about it week in, week out. Lukaku hopefully fully fit and starts. Kone started last week. Still struggling to get used to the pace of Premiership football again. So there's a lot of big, you know, question marks over certain players. We talk about being a big, you know, the manager's come out and said he doesn't think there'd be much transfer activity in the summer, not that too much. I think they've got a few players with question marks on them. They might maybe look to move on in the summer and maybe wheel and deal somewhere else. So, you know, a lot of players are playing for the future.
What is going on with the penalty kicks? I mean, Everton had one of the best penalty takers in Europe in Leighton Baines, missed only one out of 18 or whatever it was. Then Morales steals the ball and misses. Yeah. Get another penalty, as you say, against Burnley last weekend. And Ross Barkley steps up to take it.
Well, again, we come back to the good old days. But in our day, before you went on the pitch, you knew who your penalty taker was. And you'd come up to him and say, David, he still fancy penalties today, whether he'd missed it or not. And then it'd be up to the player to say, yeah, I fancy that. But I think Roberto's a believer that whoever feels confident at the time, step up and take it. So as soon as the penalty was given, and it shouldn't have been a penalty anyway, the defence took place outside the box on Pienaar, Ross Barkley right to the ball first. I don't think Leighton Baines is the confrontational type, you know, to go up and grab the ball off Ross Barkley. So they let it get to Ross, unfortunately. It was a good save from the goalkeeper, but if you're asking me, old school, you've got a penalty taker before you go out on the pitch, and for me that should be Leighton Baines.
So I think it's weak management. I think it's incumbent on Roberto Martinez as manager to say, you, Leighton Baines, are our best penalty taker. You will take it if we get one.
I find it hard to believe how Leighton, given the experience now, he's not a young lad by any stretch, doesn't have the strength of character to, you know, to just say, no,
it's odd.
Why change? I'm the man. I can put him in. I mean, it was a poor penalty as well by Barkley, I have to say. I mean, if it had been something exceptional by the keeper, you might have sort of said, well, he's unfortunate, but he wasn't even lucky in my book. It was very, very odd, and it could have been costly for Everton because obviously you get a breakthrough against Burnley early on, That makes the job a hell of a lot easier because they're pretty well organised. So they were a bit fortunate to get out of it in a way. But having said that, Everton thoroughly deserved the win over the 90 minutes. Burnley were very, very poor. I mean,
just can't score.
Didn't lay a glove on Everton at all, did they? No. I thought they were looking very ordinary.
We just spoke before, talking about the boy Danny Ings, who's been linked with a lot of top clubs, if you like. And I was looking forward to seeing him, but I don't know whether because it was a team he was playing in and whether if he goes to another team, he gets better service. But he didn't really show to me that he's the makings of a top striker. So it'd be an interesting for Burnley if they do go down. Who takes a chance on Danny Ings?
It's definitely the thing with signings. People get this impression of a player. You see snippets of them on TV and what have you, and you think, oh, yeah, he must be good because you're being told, first and foremost, by certain people that he's good. I think when you see them, they don't live up to expectations. I saw Ings against Liverpool, and again, I thought, what's all the fuss? I mean, OK, he worked hard, but, I mean, that's a given. And against Everton, very, very similar. He doesn't look a player who perhaps is ready yet for a top... six team, I think, in the Premier League.
I think if you're drawing comparisons to the other player at the moment, Charlie Austin at QPR, who could go down as well, I think there'd be more people probably have a go at Charlie Austin and think, he looks more of a threat, if you like, when the ball's in and around the box. I thought Ings, sometimes last week, or most of the time last week, the game was passing him by.
Liverpool go to the Hawthorns to play West Brom this weekend. Fourth place now gone, with City winning last weekend.
Well, I wouldn't say it's gone. I think Liverpool have to win all their games and then see how it all pans out. A lot of big games to come. Everton playing United at the weekend is a big fixture in terms of Liverpool, I would say. City playing Villa as well. Who knows how Villa will come? How they match up against City. Mm-hmm. So there are plenty of points to play for, and I wouldn't write it off. But Liverpool have made it very hard for themselves. But they've got winnable games, I would say, from now to the end of the season. Chelsea, by then they could have won the league by the time Liverpool gets to Stamford Bridge, so anything could happen there. But Liverpool have plenty to play for. They've got to keep going right to the end. But you don't know what you're going to get when you play West Brom.
True. I mean, as I said earlier, I'm not certain Brendan Rodgers will survive the summer, which makes the remaining fixtures, irrespective of whether they're chasing Champions League or not, really important. If they were to finish with dodgy results in the final set of fixtures, that might just tip the balance for John Henry and Werner to say we need a change of manager.
Yeah, it's certainly. I mean, it's difficult to read exactly how the ownership feel because we don't hear from them very often. They're very silent and they will have their ideas on how they see the club going and hopefully it's not in the way that maybe Newcastle are going and seeing that it's a profit making in industry. It's about delivering big prizes on the pitch, and if they are, then the last games are going to be certainly meaningful to all concerned, and I think Liverpool fans really want to see them finish strong. They've got winnable games, as I say, and I would think it will impact on how the club goes forward and what's available to spend and what have you throughout the summer on how Liverpool finish the season.
Could it be that we saw the end of Steven Gerrard's career at Wembley last weekend? Do you think he will be picked in the remaining games? Or I mean, he looked a fish out of water last week. He was playing in the wrong position, in my view, but he looked a tired. Old footballer last weekend.
I think he's absolutely devastated. I think what has happened to Steven Gerrard is, me as a Liverpool fan, I can't believe it. It's a nightmare scenario for me personally. I think Steven Gerrard has plenty to offer. And the fact, obviously, that the last 3 or 4 weeks have been very, very difficult with the Manchester United scenario. So I think to criticise Stevie after last week would be unfair.
No, I wasn't criticising. I'm just saying that could have been the watershed.
Still think he's got games to play for Liverpool still. I still think he gives Liverpool something different, and I wouldn't be surprised to see him starting in the game between now and the end of the season.
Yeah, I hope he does. I hope he's able to lift himself, because I think we all thought that perhaps he might really go out on a high with the coincidence of his birthday being on cup final day and all that type of stuff. So I do know that he's deflated after what has happened, and hopefully he can pick himself up and go out with a real show of what he has been to Liverpool, because it'd be a terrible way if his career with Liverpool just sort of goes out now on a low, like it, as we've kind of suffered over the last few days.
OK, we'll be back for the final part when we'll be looking at the mess that is Tranmere Rovers.
Free lawnmower removal with every grass laid, because you'll never have to mow again. Football Friday, brought to you by Elite Lawns. No mud, no mowing, no mess.
Hi, and welcome back to the final part of Football Friday. Just a reminder, if you want to contact us and take us to task over anything or compliment my two guests here, you can use the email, footballfriday@baytvliverpool.com. OK, Tranmere Rovers have two games to save their Football League status and possibly two games to save themselves, period.
We seem to talk about it every single week. You know, hasn't been many highs in recent weeks. We thought, you know, the results against Shrewsbury, where they looked, oh, yeah, we're going to get out of trouble. But it hasn't happened for them. Obviously, the manager has walked away, which I find a strange decision. Only been in for a short time. With two games to go to walk out,
I think from what I can gather, I mean it was not made clear, but I think he took such abuse. I think they lost at home to Oxford last week, and I think the fans turned on him, and I think he just basically said, "Whoa, this mess is not my mess. Mm. It's not my fault." As you say, he's only been there a few months.
I still think it was a strange thing for him. I can understand. I can't understand the fans having a go at him, because I think the mess was well before he took over. He's tried his best. He hasn't been able to do it. We've talked about it week in, week out, about bringing loan players in, doing this, trying this. You know, they've conceded too many goals. So obviously the fans are frustrated, really, really frustrated. But to take out Mickey Adams, I'm not so sure. He's had to deal with players that other managers have had as well. And they've proven that they can't do the job. So a little bit disappointing for Tranmere, but no, I think that's same for me. I think it doesn't
they're away at Plymouth this weekend, who are going well, pushing for promotion.
And Bury.
And they're 2 points adrift to Hartlepool. We've got a home game tomorrow. Basically, Tranmere have got to win their last two games and hope. Mm.
So it doesn't look good at all. But what I didn't like about Mick Adams' comments a few weeks ago, saying that he'd done it all, now it was down to the players. I thought that was unwise. I thought that sends out the wrong message. And it gave me the impression that he hasn't got the fans on his, you know, he's never really had the fans on his side. And I've had a link with Tranmere myself. I mean, I've been always very interested to see how they, you know, sort of develop and what's going on there. And I think more and more that if you're going to bring a man into somewhere like Tranmere, I think they've got to have a link. They've got to hit it off with the fan base and whatever. And I don't think he got off on the right start at all. I don't think he was ever seen as really maybe the man for Tranmere.
I think they would have done better to bring back an ex-player or promote from within, somebody who knows the club.
Promote from within. They had John McMahon, you know, I think it was last year, and John McMahon did okay, and then all of a sudden they got rid of him and made a change and thinking this is going to be. So I can understand to a certain extent, but sometimes it's not as simple as that. You know, and that is a hard job for anybody, you know, whether it be Mickey Adams, whether it be John McMahon, whoever. If you're not getting the money and you're not getting the resources, I know it's difficult down there, but if you're not getting the resources to buy better players, you're always going to be involved in the relegation scrap. It's a fact. Now, you know, Tranmere fans, whether they like it or not, have got to realise this is a position their club are in. You know, it's a poor position, and it's only going to get worse, you know, unless somebody comes in and starts to invest in the football club and buy better players. And when you buy better players, 9 times out of 10 means that you rise up the league. Not necessarily saying splash the cash to get promoted, but they wouldn't have been in this position, you know. And was it wise to get rid of John McMahon, who did ever so well? He got relegated, I think, maybe in the last day or the second last week. Mm. Why not keep faith with him? But they didn't. He wanted to, which is fine. But they had to realise that whoever they brought in was never going to be a miracle worker, not with what he had at his disposal.
They've fallen so far. I mean, it's not. Yeah. It is a long time ago, but in football terms, it's not. When they were pushing to get into the Premier League, League Cup final. And now they could be out of the Football League completely in a fortnight.
I think the limbo that perhaps they found themselves in with, obviously, the Peter Johnson's ill health and having to live out the country and what have you, maybe destabilised them a little bit and what was going on, and maybe there wasn't a strong sort of finger on the pulse, you know, as it was going on. And before you know where you are, you're on that sort of slippy slope, and they've dropped and then I mean, bringing Rob Edwards in, I don't think was, you know, wasn't perhaps the worst signing. Whether or not he was perhaps as well, he was jettisoned a little bit too early, you know.
It's a catalogue of mistakes, really, isn't it?
It seems like it. And talking to people who support Grimsby and the like, I mean, once you go into the conference, I mean, you look where Grimsby, I couldn't believe it, Grimsby, Torquay, clubs like that, you completely disappear from view. It's really ominous.
I was living in Southport when they were in the Football League.
Yeah.
And I remember when they went out, they said, we'll be back very quickly. Mm. And of course, they've never got back.
Well, you look at if they do go down, which is looking very, very likely, and then you look at the crowds.
Yeah.
And what is their ambition to get straight back up? Mm. For ambition to go straight back up, we talked about it last week. You need to put money in at the conference as well. Eastleigh are the team that just got promoted into the conference this year. They're backed by a multi-millionaire and they're up in the playoffs at the moment. Yeah. But as David says there, Grimsby, Lincoln, teams at Torquay, teams that have been in the, are not Hereford yet.
A long time. I mean, Torquay get 2,000 fans now even in the thingy, which is, you know, which is respectable. I think Grimsby getting between 3,000 and 4,000 in the. Well, Tranmere won't get anywhere near that. It's unbelievable. It's really ominous.
Anyway, we wish them well.
Yes.
During the last 7 days, Graham Sharp has transformed from former footballer into Mystic Meg. Last week, we asked Graham who he thought would progress through to the Champions League semi-finals, and 4 out of 4.
I did. I wish I'd have put some money on it. It was tough at the time, but. You know, I remember Gary sitting here, he wasn't sure whether Real Madrid would beat Athletic. I fancied Real Madrid to win. They did do. You know, Bayern Munich were impressive.
Fantastic.
Really, really impressive. Juventus, I always thought they were going to be too strong for Monaco. And what was the last one?
Barcelona. You went with the four favourites. Yeah. Real hadn't beaten Atletico in 8 games, but still in all this season, I think. But still in all, you had to fancy Real Madrid.
They were great games. And I started watching the Madrid derby, and I must admit, I turned it off and turned it over to the other game because I couldn't take the play acting. I mean, these are world-class. Sergio Ramos is a fantastic player. But if you go within
hard defender as well.
Yeah, but if you go within 3 feet of him, he falls over clutching his face. Mm. And this was endemic in this game. Mm. Every time two players clashed, one of them went to the ground holding his face.
I suppose with the Spanish referee, you don't get away with that in that derby match. The fact that it was a foreign referee who seemed to sway towards Real Madrid, I think their tactics changed. Real, that's probably why they're beaten by Atletico so much in a Spanish game. Spanish referees know what the characters are like and they're much harder. I mean, Atletico really get about you normally, don't they? And I think Real used that as
Who's
a card.
Who's going to win it? Mystic Meg?
Mystic Meg, I'm going to go for... I have to go for Bayern Munich.
David?
Barcelona.
I'll go for Bayern as well.
And what about the Europa League? I said to you the last time that Kiev would not get through. They beat Everton and I didn't think they were a great side. They went out last night to Fiorentina.
I thought Wolfsburg would win that this year. Mm. I thought they would, but they got hammered over an aggregate by Rafa Benitez's Napoli.
Yeah.
So, actually, the Europa League's been pretty good this
year. Well, you look at the teams left in both competitions, the top sides, you know, both in the Champions League and in the Europa League as well.
I think we frown on the Europa League. I think the early stages are mishmash and what have you, but once you get to the knockout stages, then quality then emerges.
I think the only problem with the Europa League is it does tend to affect a team's league form. Mm. I think Everton have suffered this season, and next season they'll be unencumbered by
That's the case. I didn't really think that the Europa League travels that we had this year were really bad. I think that a lot of our games were in, you know, close by. Mm. Okay, the exception was maybe Kiev and the Russian one in the group qualifiers, but I think we weren't too bad. So I don't think you can blame Everton's poor season, if you like, on the Europa League this year. I honestly don't.
I was thinking about having a section on the show towards the end of people who speak complete nonsense. And this week's nomination is Baroness Karen Brady, the West Ham vice chairman, who publicly announced that they were going to slash the prices for season tickets when they moved to the Olympic Stadium in season after next, and called upon all other clubs to follow her lead and cut their ticket prices. Now, this is a cynical marketing ploy. The Olympic Stadium will hold 54,000 and they can't fill it. Therefore, logic dictates that you cut the prices.
Mm. Well, the West Ham one is interesting. I think the Olympic Stadium may appeal to a sort of a wider spread of West Ham fans, and it won't necessarily come from in and around Upton Park. So these people who are out at Chelmsford and the likes of that, for the Olympic Stadium now, becomes much more appealing. So I've had sort of a thought that perhaps it's going to work, and there's a huge appeal for Olympic, the season they go into, the Olympic season tickets. People are trying to get on the waiting list now. They're going on the waiting list for tickets at Upton Park for next season, knowing they're not going to get them, but they will get them for the Olympics.
But the great benefactor, West Ham United, have actually increased their ticket prices for the last season at Upton Park.
Well, I think that Everton go there in a couple of weeks, and I think they're charging £55 for a wee support. That is obscene.
Well, you won't get a ticket next season in Upton Park.
Well, I mean, I've long believed that clubs like Everton and Liverpool, who are fair priced, should go tit for tat. Mm. West Ham charge Evertonians £55. Charge their punters 55 when they come.
I don't know. Is there something that says they can't do it? They can't do that. But
you've got the lowest price for the home supporters or something. But that's £55 for an away, and they know, as you said, they know they'll get it. It's Everton's last away game. You know, it's wrong for me.
Okay, that's the end of another show. Thank you very much to Graham and David. Fingers crossed for Tranmere Rovers and the two Mersey Giants. Join us again next week on Football Friday.
Safe for the family, including the dog. Football Friday, brought to you by Elite Lawns.